So, good morning, everyone. My name is Oliver Ragnarsson, and I'm gonna give you a short introduction to the Wharf weather model, and also introduction to Iceland Geosurvey and the Belgian Gjóa. And tomorrow, I'll give a more detailed description on the operational and on-demand forecast solution. So, but today we are introducing the Wharf modeling system in a, and I'll be using material from my colleagues at NOAA or NCAR, Jimmy Dudia, Duda, and Wei Wang. So the outline of the talk, as I mentioned, quick introduction to ESOR, the Iceland Geosurvey, and Belgian Gjóa and atmospheric modeling, doing that in two slides, which Haraldur has been giving a more detailed introduction to. And then the pre-processing of the Wharf modeling system, the model physics themselves. I'll go very fast over that. Model physics is a topic that could last for 10 workshops, and indeed, there are dedicated workshops just on individual sectors of the individual model physics. And then also a few slides on basically how to run the model and visualize the data. And this topic will be covered in more detail by Joe here later today and tomorrow, and as well as other sectors of other parts of the modeling part. And then the forecast suite, we'll talk about that tomorrow. Now, Haraldur and I, we come from Iceland, and I'm actually, at the moment, I'm positioned here in Bergen, and Carolina is from Poland, and Joe from Brazil. So I'm trying to plot that on Google Earth, and we just managed to get it on a one without rotating the globe. So yeah, coming from here and here and down here, and well, this is a bit cheating. He's actually, he went from here to here and then here. So we have a kind of a closed loop to show where we are coming from.
Well, I did not fly over Syria.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, the track was more like here.
In fact,
And Joe and I also noticed that we did not take the shortest route. We had a kind of a detour to the east, so probably to bypass Syria and Iraq. So your detour was more to the west.
It's over Cairo instead.
ESOR, also known as Iceland Geosurvey, it was established in 2003, when the Geoscience Division of the National Energy Authority was spun off as a separate entity. It's defined, it's a self-financing, state-owned, nonprofit institution, and it has more than 6 decades of experience in the fields of geothermal and hydropower research and development. And for the past almost 40 years, it has been providing more than half of the teaching staff of the United Nations University Geothermal Training Program, which has been operated in Iceland since 1979. And at the moment, there are two other UN universities training programs operating in Iceland, one in fishery and one in land use and land restoration. Belgian Gjóa, the company was founded in 2001 by myself and Haraldur here. Currently, it's a mixed private and governmental ownership, mostly private, but 10% of the company is owned by Iceland Geosurvey. And we have a strong tradition in atmospheric research, mainly in research in flow and complex terrain, and also in dynamical downscaling of past and present and also future climate scenarios. We have been running operational forecasts since 2004. Initially, we focused on Iceland, of course, as that's our home country. But in later years, we have also been doing operational forecast for North Atlantic in general, parts of Europe and in the past year and a half for various countries here in Africa. We also developed an what we called an on-demand forecasting system, and it came online in 2012. It's called SAR Weather, stands for Search and Rescue Weather, and is used by search and rescue operators both in Iceland, and it's also a service provided to the Global Disaster Alert and Coordination System. So, which is the GDACS is a consortium of between the UN and the European Commission. So our network is quite extensive. We have been a long-time collaborators with NOAA ESRL in Boulder, and typically we go there, try to go there every second year at least for a short to medium long stays. We've been collaborating with ESOR since 2001 basically, and the Icelandic Met Office. We were a service provider for them between 2004 and 2012, and we've been participating in a number of both domestic and international projects with the Icelandic Met Office. We have a long-term collaboration with the University of Bergen in Norway and the University of Iceland and the Reykjavik University. And as I mentioned, we are service providers to the GDACS, the Icelandic Power Company, road authorities, and formerly to the Icelandic Met Office, and Eneco Limited in the Netherlands, and as well as 365 Media in Iceland. So, enough of that. Atmospheric models, as Haraldur came into, we have the set of equations that describe the atmospheric flow, and these equations need to be integrated forward in time to produce a weather forecast. And what we do with a limited area model is that we take initial and boundary data from a global model to initiate and drive the limited area model. And the reason for that is mainly CPU power. If you want to capture the effects of, say, the terrain on the atmospheric flow, you need to be able to represent the terrain sufficiently well so that steep mountains are seen by the model. Unless if the steep mountain is not seen by the model, the effect the mountain has on the flow is not seen by the model. So this means that we need high resolution by, say, maybe 1 kilometer. And if you want to run a 1 kilometer forecast for the whole globe, you either have to be very patient or have a extremely big and powerful computer. So as to compensate for that, we have a relatively coarse global model, and we can use initial and boundary conditions from this global model to force a smaller or limited area model which has a higher resolution, and then capturing or focusing on a smaller area. And the WWF weather research and forecasting model is an example of a local area model which is used exactly for that, mainly used for that purposes. It's an open source model developed in collaboration developed in the US between NCAR, NOAA, the Air Force Agency, NRL, University of Oklahoma, and the FAA. And also there are a number of both universities in South America and Asia, as well as Europe, that are contributing to the modeling development. But it has 5 development teams and 16 work groups and more than 160 official developers. And then, as I mentioned, there's an additional development done by academic and governmental institutions in the US and abroad. And it has a very large user community. The number 20,000 was the number of registered users some 3 or 4 years ago. So this number could easily be 30,000 or even higher by now. And it has an excellent user support, as its predecessor, the MM5 model, had. It's,
how many of the users are in Africa?
I don't, actually. I think this would be an excellent, very interesting...
greater than I thought.
Yeah, I think it's... and as I said, this number is something I heard from Dutia, Jim Dutia, 3 or 4 years ago, so...
If you have a group of 10 people working with the Wolf model, for instance, in some institution here, they all list as individuals.
Yes, I think they do.
It's emails and that sort of
Yeah, yeah. And to get access to the users forum, yeah. etc. So and listing is free and so there are no strings attached to become a member of the email list and such and such.
This could mean many hundreds or even thousands individual groups.
Yes. This is just individual uses.
So what you are basically saying is that if a typical big model in the world is like this, then the Wolf community is like that.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's non-hydrostatic, but you can also run it in hydrostatic mode if you want. And it has a very wide range of scales. So it can be used for both idealistic and real-world applications. There's a number of data simulation options, and it has been modified for volcanic applications to calculate the dispersion of volcanic constituents like ash and gases. And we have used it in that mode in Iceland, for example. And it also includes a dust module for resuspension of dust and ash. So that's one thing we want to apply the Pan-Africa model for, so that we can simulate the uptake of Saharan dust, for example. Because that has the aerosols have a large impact on the development of tropical cyclones. This is a schematic of the flowchart of the model. I will be focusing on, might say, the lower part here, so on the pre-processing system, the real part, and then running the model. And to do that, you need some static data to represent the terrain, topography, and soil properties of the area you want to simulate for. And then you need input from a global model, either as a forecast mode or in a downscaling mode. So you either have a forecast from ECNWF or the GFS, or a reanalysis data from like the MERA dataset from NASA, or the Aero Interim from the ECNWF. So the pre-processing system of the Wolf model, as the name implies, the purpose of this pre-processing system is to prepare input into the Wolf simulation, for the real data simulation. So we first need to define the domain, and we can also use we can zoom in and have a nests within our domain to have even higher resolution. We need to compute the latitude, the longitude, the scale factors, and also the Coriolis parameter at every grid point, because the Coriolis parameter changes between if you go north and south. So it's not constant within the whole domain. And we also need to interpolate the constant terrestrial data, like the topography and the soil type. And then we also need to interpolate the time-varying, the meteorological fields, that we are getting input from the global or large-scale model. And this has to fit into our grid. So the pre-processing part is set up of three or four modules, actually. One is here called the ungrip, is to take the data from the global model, the meteorological fields. And then we have what's called geogrid or geography, to take the static geographical data like the topography and soil And then this is ingested into the math grid, which puts it into the right, interpolates it into the right grid, which we have defined here. And then in real, we also need to do a vertical interpolation. And then we have finally input data that can be fed into the WRF model itself. So there are a number of steps that need to be taken before you can run a forecast or a simulation with the WRF model. As I said, GeoGrid is to define our domain. The UnGrid is to prepare the data from the global model that we are using as initial and boundary conditions. And then the MathGrid part is to interpolate these fields into our domain or grid that we have defined here in GeoGrid. So if you go in slightly more detail into the GeoGrid program, and it's basically it defines the projection, and the by projection we have the option of Mercator, which is suitable for equatorial and the subtropics. We have the Lambert, which is good for mid latitudes, and then we have polar stereographic, which is suitable for maybe 60, 65 degrees north and south, so for the higher latitude regions. And this GeoGrid program, or the output from the GeoGrid, provides values for the static fields. As I said, the latitude, longitude, Coriolis and a map scale factor, and also the static terrestrial data. And it also has the option of having higher, even a domain within the domain. So if you want to have a 1 kilometer simulation, it's usual to go from a global model which has maybe 50 kilometer resolution or 60 kilometer resolution, and you have that data and you run a, say, 27 kilometer resolution WRF domain. But within that you have another 9 kilometer resolution domain, and within that you have a 3 kilometer resolution domain, and then finally the innermost domain is 1 kilometer, which is the resolution you want to focus on. It, by going directly from the global model to a 1 kilometer resolution, it's not recommended. It might work sometimes, but it might also produce some very strange results without you realizing that what you're getting out of your 1 kilometer simulation is strange. So it's, you have to be careful. And what's meant by a two-way nest, one-way nest versus two-way nest, is that a two-way nest, then what's happening in the, say, 1 kilometer domain, that information is propagated back into the 3 kilometer domain, and then you can cascade it out. And you have to be careful if you have these two-way nests. You have there's a slightly more restriction on how you set up the nest. The two-way nest may not overlap. So here's an example of how to do it. So the outermost domain has a 45 kilometer grid resolution, and within it you have a 15 kilometer domain, and within that you have a 5 kilometer domain, but you also have the option of having another 15 kilometer domain outside the what's called domain 2. But say, if this would be a two-way nesting, then this green domain here would not be allowed to overlap with another blue domain, 15 kilometer. Because that basically means you would be propagating information from this domain and this domain to the last domain for the same area here of the overlapping area. That's not allowed. And it's called the nesting structure is shown there on the right. And this, the way you control this location of inner domains and the domain itself is set in a file called namelist.wps. And in that file, you also define the, for example, you also define the map projection you want to use. You also define the location of the input files that are coming from ungrip, and etc. So this is the name list of the VPS file is the file you need to edit to set up your domain and do the pre-processing. Yeah, this is, as I said before, this is what you do in the geogrid and the interpolation that's done of the static fields. And what's happening here is that you have a global model which is latitude, longitude, and this, you know, they are, but you're creating a domain that's basically a box, a square. And the point here to keep in mind is that if you have, say, easterly winds here, then they are going along this line here in the latitude longitude global model. But in the Wharf model, the east-west component is just a straight line. It's not. So if we are somewhere here in the middle, then a easterly wind in the model, yeah, it would be an mostly easterly wind in the real world as well. But if we are, say, out here, and you have a easterly wind component, then you need to split it up into a real eastward and real north-southward, because if you have a straight line here, then it's not easterly wind, and it's blowing more to the southeast in reality. So that's one thing you need to keep in mind when interpreting the output from the Wharf model, is that east-west in the model may not be, and most likely is not, real east-west. So you need to rotate the output into Earth coordinates. So the output is you create a output file, one file per domain, and they are labeled like this, geo underscore em, and then domain 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. And here's an example of the output fields. You have the land-sea mask, topography, some top layer soil categories, and vegetation fractions. And that was for GeoGrid and for UnGrip, which I've talked about also. It's a program to read the output data from the global models. It can be, it's called GRIP, the gridded binary. It can both handle edition 1 and the later, more recent edition 2 files. And it extracts the meteorological fields from these global models. And it also has the potential of computing derived fields. Say if relative humidity is not output from the model you're using, but you have the temperature, the pressure, and the specific humidity, then UnGrip can calculate the relative humidity for you. And then it writes the requested fields into an intermediate file format. And the reason we need this is that GRIP data from, say, the GFS model of NOAA is not exactly the same format as GRIP data from the European Center Medium Range Weather Forecast System. So GRIP data is a standard, but it's not that standardized in a way. And that's why you need a table, interpretation table, called V-tables or variable tables. And these tables are kind of the key to unlock or correctly interpretate the GRIP files. So you have a different V-table for the GFS data, for example. You have a different table for ECMWF, NOAA-RAC, etc., etc. But luckily, the good people at Wharf have provided us with tens of different V-tables to handle varying sources of GRIP data. So for the largest part of the time you don't have to worry about it, but you have to, when you're doing your first work, you have to be careful to choose the right weed table, because you could actually ungrip data set with the wrong weed table and actually get, you know, the model may not necessarily crash, but again you'll be getting something very strange that you'd be then putting into your model. So once we have extracted the data we want using the correct weed table and a proper grip data, then we have data sets on what's called intermediate format. And this output files, they typically have names something like, what is it, file, and then you have a string that defines the time. So year, month, day, and hour. And this is a timestamp for the data field you have, and all times are in UTC. So, and this is actually the files that the MathGrid program reads and interpolates to your domain that you have defined here in GeoGrid. So, and it is, yeah, to be more specific, it only does horizontal interpolation. So it extracts the data, reads the data from the ungrip, and puts it on the domain that you have defined in GeoGrid. And it also handles what's called the masked interpolation for masked fields. And basically it doesn't worry about what is your vertical coordination set. So it's whether it's native coordinates or isobaric coordinates. So it's not worrying about what's happening in the vertical, it's just handling horizontal interpolation on each individual level. And there it also rotates the winds from the, you know, the real latitude longitude onto the wharf grid, which is the box we defined. By a mast field we mean, like, example would be a sea surface temperature. You do not have sea surface temperature inland, that's what's called sea surface temperature. And same way you would not have like vegetation fraction at sea. You only have vegetation fraction over land. So these are example of fields that either consist on land or sea, and then also there are other fields like connected to urban, like cities, etc. And these fields, they need to be correctly interpolated onto our grid. And this is done in MathGrid.
What happens when you have clouds or clouds?
Clouds are not per se input into the model. So they are not, we are not putting clouds here. You have relative humidity, but that's not a mast field. So you have relative humidity everywhere. But the mast is something like if you have only over land or only over sea, and then you need to, like here on the left, this is a field that has been, skin temperature field that has been interpolated just using a smooth interpolation. And it's, you know, I think this is Florida here and the east coast of the US. And it's kind of, you see it's kind of blurry. But once you have interpolated using a mask which defines the coastline, then you have a much sharper edge.
But it's an important question on the clouds, because it arises the fact that the model needs time to develop clouds and precipitation, several hours at least.
Yeah, that's one thing we'll be discussing later on. It's the onset of convection, for example. You may have a high resolution model, and then you may experience strange things happening in the first maybe couple of hours of the simulation when the model is basically adjusting to the input data, which may originate from a much coarser domain or coarser resolution data set. So, yeah, the MathGrid writes out, again, file, and it writes out files, one file per time step and domain. So you have, here's an example of, so math underscore EM, then you have the domain number, and then you have the, again, timestamp to say, okay, this is snapshot for this domain at this particular time. And here's just an example of output from the MathGrid. And also it's a good idea to quickly go over your MathEM files to see if there is something strange there, like say sea surface temperature. Is it on the right order or is it zero? Then if it's zero, then it means something has gone wrong in the previous steps. So we have created our domain. We have worked with the input weather fields from the global model, and this has now been put onto a correct horizontal grid using the MathGrid data file program. Sorry, but the last step is then called real, which handles the vertical interpolation of the input data and creates the final input files that we drive our simulation with. So, once we have created the input files, we need to basically decide the setup of our model. And the WRF model is really a set of modules, where each module handles radiation, what's happening at the surface, what's happening in the boundary layer, how do we handle turbulence or friction, as Haraldur mentioned, how do we handle cumulus parameterizations and microphysics. And all these modules interact, and the complexity of the interaction varies, and the complexity of individual modules varies as well. And as you can see here in radiation, we have radiation has been split up into long wave radiation and short wave radiation. So you have a number of options of programs to handle the long wave or simulate the long wave physics, radiation, and the short wave physics as well. And the radiation then also interacts with the microphysics and other modules of the model. And it's also important to keep in mind that if you change, say you want to experiment with the boundary layer physics of the model, you also have to remember that the PBL schemes, they interact with the surface scheme. And if you change, say, a PBL scheme, you may have to change the surface scheme. And then the question arises, okay, the difference I see in the model output, is it just from the PBL scheme? Or is it also connected to the surface scheme? Most likely, it's a combination. And that's one of the beauty and also one of the very, very difficult tasks to estimate the difference between simulation is that they are a combination of factors. It's not just changing one PBL scheme or one parameter. It all works together. And here's a, believe me, this is a simplified diagram of the interaction of various schemes or various, not schemes, but various modules of the model. So we have up here, we have microphysics, and through microphysics affects the radiation. And the radiation affects the surface through, say, downward shortwave radiation and downward longwave radiation, but the surface also affects the radiation by emission, surface emission and albedo, so outgoing longwave and shortwave. microphysics also affects the cumulus scheme, and it also affects the surface by precipitation. The cumulus scheme also affects the microphysics through cloud detrainment. That limits the amount of humidity or ice particles or water vapor particles that the microphysics can deal with. The surface is also affected by the PBL scheme, and vice versa. PBL scheme, the lower boundary data for the PBL scheme, they come from the surface scheme, like the surface fluxes and specific humidity and latent heat. So this is a schematic to keep in mind that all these modules are connected, and they to a various degree affect each other. And here's a schematic of the radiation processes, and here we have the it's basically an incoming long wave and short wave. We have the reflection that Harald showed earlier, and then we have cloud formation, or we have clear sky, and then the clouds also interact with what's happening above them and below them, and the surface is interacting with the surface layer and then the free boundary layer and the free atmosphere. The long wave radiation handles the what's called the clear sky and cloud upward and downward radiation fluxes. It needs to consider the infrared emissions from individual model layers, and we also need to think about the surface emissivity based on the land type. Is it freshly fallen snow, for example, which has a very high albedo? Is it sea ice, or is it open water, or is it a forest, green leaf forest, etc.? And these things are represented in the long wave radiation schemes, and again they vary in complexity. The short wave computes the clear sky and cloudy solar fluxes. It also includes the annual income or changes in the annual income of solar radiation, just based on winter, summer, etc., and also a diurnal changes. And most of the scheme consider both downward and upward fluxes. By that we mean it's upward flux. You have, say, you have a ice cap or a glacier, and you have a incoming solar shortwave radiation, and then part of that is bounced back up again. But the simplified UDS scheme has only the downward part, and we found out in Iceland that this scheme was too simplified and created problems over the ice caps, because it did not capture the upgoing shortwave, which could then interact with low-level clouds or fog and bounce back again. So we need to change to a more complex shortwave scheme to capture the radio energy budget over the ice caps correctly. And this is certainly a important factor in the surface energy balance that we found out. So again, the surface atmospheric surface layer, which is just above the ground, is contributing to the land surface model and to the BBL scheme as well. And this is through the exchange of coefficients for heat and moisture, and also for friction, stress, and what's called the water surface fluxes of heat and moisture. So energy transport, basically, it's energy transport, and these are just different means to break that energy transport down into the models. And also the land surface model has effect on the PBL scheme through fluxes of heat and moisture as well. There are a number of what's called the surface layer option in WRF. Many of them use the Monin-Nabokov similarity theory. These are also needed to provide these exchange coefficients between the land surface model and the PBL scheme, as I showed earlier, and the surface fluxes. And yeah, here's an example of a land surface model. It says, again, they vary in complexity. This would be an example of a complex model, which is taking into its precipitation, and it's also trying to simulate the effects that vegetation has on the energy balance at the surface through transpiration from the growth, and also that vegetation can basically withhold vapor for a different length of times. And I believe that's what's called NOAA multiphysics model is trying to do. They're trying to simulate the effects different types of vegetation have on the energy balance at the surface. So it's that again is a field where you can have 2 weeks workshop just focusing on that part of the model. And also it has effect on snowpack and what happens to the snowpack, how does the snow change with time, how much melts, how does the albedo of the snow change as it grows older. So there's a huge number of factors that have to be taken into consideration, and I can say without feeling ashamed that I have very little knowledge on most of the things that are happening in this part of the model. The model can be very, very specialized. And as I said, there's a reason there are 16 working groups within the WRF consortium, because one of the groups is just focusing on this part. And in that you have other five groups, and you have, there are dozens and dozens of people just focusing on this single part of the model.
But when you are running a 1 kilometer model, you have to take all this into consideration.
Yes.
And if you are, for example, in Iceland, and how would you know what is happening like in the Indian Ocean? Where do you get your information, for example?
For Iceland, we are doing a limited area forecast. So we use data from both the GFS and the ECMWF. But we only take out a window from the GFS that covers maybe large part of the North Atlantic. So in a way, what's happening in the Indian Ocean has to go through the global model to our border. So in our limited area model, we are not directly simulating what's happening outside our domain, but that information comes in through the domain, through the boundary of our domain, through the global model.
Yeah, but if you are running 1 kilometer in the Indian Ocean, where do you get the information of the Indian Ocean? Since you don't have the knowledge of the Indian Ocean.
No, you have the global model. The global models are coupled. And they are, typically they are coupled with, so atmosphere, ocean, and the waves, or the energy transport at the boundaries of the atmosphere and ocean.
But the global models won't give you things like mountains, if you have rivers.
No, they don't.
This information you have to download before.
You have to download before.
So in the USGS webpage, you can download geography data that has information about land use, soil information.
So that is part of the static data that you put into the GeoGrid part in the beginning.
Yeah.
And that's also, if you have a more detailed information, that would be the place to feed them into the model at the right of the beginning of the GeoGrid part. Where were we? Yes, okay, so the land surface models, they are driven by the surface energy and water fluxes. And this part of the model then predicts the soil temperature and soil modules in various layers down into the ground. And this number of layers, again, it differs between model types. So you have the NOAA and NOAA MP models. You have the RUC, which is a rapid update cycle. PX is PlanckCU and SSIB. So you have one, two, three, four. You have five different land surface models you can choose from using in the WRF modeling system. And these land surface models, they also predict the snow water equivalent on the ground. And again, this comes in various complexities as this may be in vertical layers or not. And some of the models can also predict canopy moisture.